The speakers themselves, I think, were selected before the election on the ground that their states of California and Texas had the largest electoral vote. And there was some feeling that if they were selected, the election would turn out better than it did. I therefore want to introduce John Henry, recognizing that for me, he is more than John Henry Faulk, more than the personification of good over evil, and more of the personification of courage over defeat. He comes from a core of Southerners. It's a small group that in the very early days were active in the civil rights movement and the civil liberties movement. And I think of Virginia Darrow is here and her husband Clifford, Aubrey Williams, and a Carl Braden, of course, later, and the man whom all of us loved and who was a close friend of John Henry, besides Clark Foreman, namely Palmer Weber, a great man. And now with this praise of all these other people, I turn Mr. Faulk over to you, remembering I have this time clock, this time bomb working. John Henry.
All right, Leonard. Thank you very much, Leonard, for that very gracious introduction. It beats the one I got last week down in B-Dye's Texas Chamber of Commerce banquet, all to holler. Fella supposed to introduce me didn't come, and they wished it off on an old boy named Jake Howard that knows me slightly. And he got up and said, "I just know two things about John Henry Faulk. And one of them is he ain't never been in a Texas penitentiary. And the other one is, I don't know why." I went to the Dr. Koval's panel on anti-communism and intellectual life in America, its impact on it, and it was the most stimulating and exciting experience this morning. And I believe it was Dr. Koval, or might have been Dr. Goo, or Ring Lardner, one of them mentioned or raised the question of whether anti-communism, repression under anti-communism had really declined some in the last 40 years. And I thought that was a remarkable coincidence because I had prepared my remarks up here today by doing research down in Texas on exactly that subject. Because of, you know, its recent presidential election, or selection, whichever you want to call it, raised this question to me when Bush came out with that cockamamie notion of his, you don't salute the flag right and fast enough to suit me. It rung a McCarthy bell in my head. At any rate, I went out to see one of the great spirits of the McCarthy period back there 40 years ago in Texas, old Buck Simpson. And Buck was always a ne'er-do-well, never could find his calling. He started a marriage bureau and about his third customer and thing, you know, by correspondence. Darn, she hauled off and married him. And then he started a patent medicine thing where he had a medicine that he invented himself. It'd cure baldness and stomach disorders. And old Roosevelt, whom he hated, sent those federal men and said it wouldn't cure neither one but would cause both, and they shut him down. One time Buck was accidentally going to the men's room in the courthouse, and there was an American Legion fella came in, and they were holding a hearing on a school teacher down there. And Buck was asking about, I said, "What y'all got her for?" And the fella said, "Well, we're gonna knock her out of the schools. We're saving these schools from the Red Menace. There's a communist conspiracy that's coming right into Bastrop County, and it's gonna take us all if we don't stay on the ball." And Buck said, "You know, I used to work for her. I used to clean her yard." And bless goodness, he got on the stand and identified her. and did it so good she tried to make a communist out of him, he said, that the American Legion came to him and an FBI man did and said, you do that so good you ought to take it up as a regular line of business. Because he talked about church and prayer and that sort of thing, and it, he said, Johnny, I got into it, and that was when it really paid. Anti-communism was as rich a field as you could have got into. And the FBI said that I'd make a lot more money if I was an ex-communist, because they can, I don't know why, but they said that you was more professional if you was. And they spent 6 months trying to locate a little dab bear in Texas for me to join. I finally found a bunch and went down there, and you know, if God hadn't called me for this work, I'd sure in hell give up. After I'd been in that damn thing for 6 months, the driest, boringest experience I ever had, it turned out every damn person in it was an FBI agent. There wasn't but one true blue, red-blooded American communist in the whole thing, and that was an old lady. And her family had been trying to commit her. She thought she was Miss America half the time and Stalin's daughter-in-law the rest of the time. And we'd have this hearing, and the FBI'd be there, and the American Legion would be there, you know, and the committee. I was head of the committee then to stop communism in Precinct 3 of Bastrop County. And we'd get all set and get the cameras there and the newspapers there. And that old silly heifer would get up and start saying, here she is, Miss America. And then, and just when he's grinding on her good, she'd start at, arise, ye prisoners of starvation. Well, it played hell with our hearing, I'll tell you that right now. People got sniggering at us. And I had to finally just, you know, settle for a job with, well, I still informed for the FBI, but it wasn't the same as it was before. And but the House Un-American Activity was real good pay if you could get, you know, flying around and doing their informing for them. And the other day, I went to hear a Latter-day gentleman, Cousin Ed Snodgrass, and I had been going around talking about Nicaragua, talking about Grenada. I took the position on Nicaragua that they finally vomited out that horrid man Somoza, drove the despised and hated National Guard out and parked them around there in Puerto Rico and Guatemala and Honduras, and our CIA went down there and hired this bunch of outlaws and scourings from the Somoza regime, bought them uniforms, suits, bought their ammunition and guns, and sent them back to kill their own folks. And I'd say, this is, you know, this grinds at me. I can't sleep good at night knowing this is happening. Cousin Ed Snodgrass is the Truth Squad. He appointed himself as Truth Squad. He's 78, and he was 8 years old when his mom and daddy told him his South lost the Civil War, and he'd been kind of pouting ever since then. Until Ronnie came. God, Ronnie just brought sunshine into his life. He'd been happier than, and he feels it's his duty to explain Ronnie Reagan to ignoramuses like me. And he'd get up after I'd go somewhere, he would truth squad me. He said, it's, there you got your liberal ignorance. There's your liberal ignorance talking about Nicaragua that way. Ronald Reagan has made a study of Nicaragua. He understands that Sandinista crowd. Hell, he's even had Ms. Kirkpatrick fly over it twice and take notes. And she's informed us. We now know the truth. You hear about them Sandinistas down there? You know what? They ain't a thing in the world but Nicaraguans too. What does that teach us about the Sandinistas? They've infiltrated their own country, by God. That's as low down as you can get. And when Ronnie, y'all remember when Ronnie Reagan got up, I think it's why I despise the damn newspaper editors of this country. They let him get away with it. He set up the mightiest nation on the face of the earth, the best armed, the most affluent, attacks the smallest, poorest island in the Caribbean Sea. And the President of the United States gets up with that fatuous idiocy of his and says, "This is our proudest moment." And I said, "This is revolting." I said, "It does injury to my sense of who we are, what we're all about. It's an outrageous thing. Cousin Ed Snodgrass got me." Oh, he jumped. He said, "Johnny, you see, there you go. You don't know the facts. Ronnie knows the facts. He got his CIA, investigated all that and gave him the real facts on. He had to do that." When he said, "This is our proudest moment," what he is saying is that he saved the United States of America. That's what he was saying. Do you realize that they got a secret plan where that bunch of stink pots was going to swing down into the Caribbean Sea, giant them Nicaraguans, and pin us in between the Arctic Circle and the Gulf of Mexico? Johnny, they'd have come through Texas like a dose of salt through a widow woman. They would have had every man, woman, and child in America damn Marxist-Leninist by daylight. That's what Ronnie saved us from. Well, I mention these matters to you to say that I ain't sure, because that was just last week he said that. And Mr. Bush said almost the same thing. So I don't know that it's lightened up any since me and Miss Decca and Leonard Boudin first got a taste of it back yonder 40 years ago. But I do want to say a word about Leonard Boudin. I didn't come to speak about him.
There are no time limitations.
No, have I run over?
You can run over as long as you want on this subject.
I see what he says. I thought I'd run out of time.
He's joking.
Leonard Boudin is one of my favorite people for many, many years. And the reason he is, my dears, and I'm closing off on this, Leonard, don't worry.
I'm not worried.
Is that he understands the genius of the First Amendment. And by genius, I mean that when Mr. Madison and the boys presented it, Mr. Madison explained that this was the genius of the American government. This amendment, "Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion, of prohibiting free exercise thereof, or abridging freedom of speech of the press, the right of the people peaceably to assemble and petition their government for the redress of grievances," protected those opinions that we loathe and despise with the same force that it protects those that we cherish and live by. This is our genius. This is who we are. This is what Leonard taught me. And it's the reason I value him and old Pablo Weber and Clark Foreman so highly, because they made that exceedingly clear. And Angel's the reason I'm dwelling on it, because I'm quite sure they're much better informed persons than myself in that area. But I wanted to end by saying, you know where this gathering started, this magnificent and inspiring anti-communist conference, or conference on anti-communism started? It started not just when it was hatched up, or not even when McCarthyism was riding high. Where it started was when some men here in Boston flung tea overboard. And then went on 3 years later in 76 to say, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are endowed by their Creator certain inalienable rights. All men are created equal, are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. Among these rights are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And to secure these rights," and here is the real hooker that nobody ever mentions anymore, "governments are instituted amongst men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed." Don't tell Ronnie, but every one of them were revolutionaries that had a price on his head. If old King George and Lord North I know one of the ancestors of Colonel North could have got their hands on him if they could have got their hands on him. The thing is that there's a straight line between that and those words after spending all the summer of 1787 shaping that magnificent document, the Constitution of the United States, into the permanent protection that every one of us has. That's when we really got started, Angels. And thank you all very much. And thank you, Leonard, for letting me run over top of
you. You did. You did.
They're telling me I hit it right on the nose. Beautiful.